Hey everyone, so once again I came to the Supercomputing Conference SC24 and it's already over.
Right, but before that happened, I went to Atlanta, saw a bunch of cool stuff, talked to many people, and once more helped build the world's fastest temporary network. This year the conference was larger than ever, and it had a surprising shift in the exhibitor focus. Quantum computing got a little sidetracked, while other areas got their time to shine. Plot twist, I'm not talking about the AI.
It's good to be back. Now, this video will be mainly split into two segments. First, I'll talk about interesting things I saw at the showroom floor. And secondly, I'll talk about Scinet. Again, because some things have changed.
Lenovo has presented their water-cooled solution, codenamed the Neptune. The server is 100% fanless. The top of the CPU cooling block is used as a place where your SSD is mounted, so that it also is cooled by water flowing through it. Notice how even RAM sticks are cooled by using padding made from material that allows delicate contact with the memory. Due to its size, the blades are mounted vertically, thanks to which everything fits into a standard server rack. You're probably thinking, but what about the power supply? It is a part of this mounting chassis and is also water-cooled. I found the Mosaic 3+ storage platform presented at Seagate to be super interesting. It uses heat-assisted magnetic recording, or a hammer for short. This technology leverages the effect known as Curie temperature. The glowing mock-up showcased how groups of ferromagnetic grains are heated up in order to make them writable. Thanks to this, at the nanoscale, disks achieve higher data density and stability. This server, outfitted fully with 30TB drives, can store up to 2.5 petabytes of data in 4U enclosure. Next Silicon is a producer of accelerator cards, but here's the kicker. Their software analyzes and profiles your application for the most repeatable chunks of operations that can be distributed across their silicon. That profiler is continuously doing its job, so as a result, your performance may increase with longer runtimes. Recently, in my storage and tape-related videos, I complained that SAS and FC are the only means to connect to interesting storage solutions, especially for home labbing. But here's where ATA comes in. They offer storage infrastructure and connectivity products, HBA, adapters, network cards, and many more. Their solutions, among other things, allow you to put your fiber channel or SAS devices on the Ethernet network and make them more easily accessible. If you're doing video production, managed storage systems, or even if you're just a home lab person, you should definitely check out their portfolio. Please remember that if you want any of the things I'm showing expanded on, you should leave a comment. This will both boost the channel statistics and let me know what you're interested in. Now, back to the main thing. Let's switch to cooling technologies. ZutaCore specializes in thermal management solutions. Their direct-to-chip, as seen here, utilizes phase change to extract the heat. Instead of pumping the water through the cooling block, a liquid that can boil between 18 to 15 degrees Celsius is used. Then, the vapor is extracted from the block and cooled down back to the liquid form. Accelsius presented similar solution. Continuing with cooling. Submer had this really cool installation showing their immersive cooling solutions. This type of cooling can also more easily recover residual heat that radiates from the chip to the motherboard. According to the monitoring dashboard, this system has been pulling 2 kW of power and yet the GPU stays at around 65 degrees Celsius. Anyway, right after that I committed an unforgivable act for which I was instantly executed. Somehow I returned and strolled around looking at networking gear. Look at this beast from Nvidia and hear me out carefully. This single 4U switch can provide 144 endpoints with 800 gigabit InfiniBand connectivity. And before you start typing comments saying,
"This switch only has 72 ports,"
I was also confused there for a second. Each one of these ports is OSFP pluggable that connects two endpoints. Supposedly, the cable looks like this. If some of you don't know what InfiniBand is, well, it's an alternative to the Ethernet. Let's leave it at that for now. But just so you know, this switch also has an Ethernet version. 64-port 800 gigabit switches are becoming the new normal. mostly due to their breakup capabilities. If you can't utilize 800 gigabit, you most often can break it into 2x400 gigabit or even more to provide nice top-of-the-rack connectivity to your high-density deployments. I also asked about those FPGA Agilex-based accelerator cards. It turns out they are widely used for video broadcasting. Thanks to their low latency and high I/O bandwidth, there are less frame drops compared to CPU-based installation. I was also pointed to an article, link in the video description, about how this technology changed this year's Paris Olympic Games broadcast. Instead of getting highly custom track of hardware with commercially available off-the-shelf gear like this, organizers have been able to squish everything into a few racks, without sacrificing performance, saving on both power and space. They can be used to accept high-resolution uncompressed camera input, and then re-export it and possibly re-encode. This is turning into quite a review, so here's a quick list of things I also found interesting. This nice visualization of cooling flows in a manifold, Linus Tech Tips cameo, Delta's cooling solution showcase, this single AI tower workstation from Lambda, this company performing computation with laser beams, and finally, Yubi-chan at Asus. I don't know if I highlighted it enough, but a lot more emphasis this year was put onto cooling solutions. Now that we are reaching 500, 600 or even 800 watts per chip, a lot new factors come into play. This is a point where just air cooling is inefficient on so many levels that it's reasonable to invest into a liquid cooling infrastructure, and many companies want a piece of that cake.
Liquid cooling infrastructure can become very complicated very quickly in a data center.
Just so we're clear, I omitted a shitload of other things that I just didn't have time to properly film or ask about. But I really, really was on tight schedule again this year. I posted some updates while I was in Atlanta, but I quickly got overwhelmed, so I fell back to photos. If you're on Instagram, you could follow the adventures of HPC Cat. Scinet, as each year, has changed their network, this time to an interesting degree. If you are new here, Scinet is a group of volunteers that builds a network platform for Supercomputing Conference, which also happens to be the world's fastest temporary network. It takes a year to plan, 3 weeks to build, and a day to dismantle. Scinet managed to acquire a new AS number, and the network was split into two parts, so now the routing team swag has two AS numbers. Science DMZ is the new addition and is tasked with providing connectivity to Network Research Exhibition, or NRE for short. NREs have always been with Scinet, but thanks to this division, the high-performance experimental part has its own devices, network, WAN peerings, and so on. The rest is being left to Core. Core network takes care of commodity connections for the exhibitors, Wi-Fi, general conference connectivity, video streaming, and probably something else I forgot at the moment. So, going back to the diagram, the division looks something like this. By the way, in my previous video, I talked about problems we've had with U1-lay switches that served as fiber termination for many connections. Well, we didn't manage to definitely conclude what the hell was going on. I think that one of the better theories was that there is some sort of weird auto-negotiation hard-coded into the SFP port, but even that didn't explain everything. So TLDR, avoid U1-lay. I was part of the routing team again this year, mostly involved with the core network. We focused on the automation with Cisco NSO and decided that our network should be a bit simpler. So instead of VXLAN EVPN, we opted for BGP with loopbacks advertised by ISIS. And you know what? Instead of doing a boring deep dive, I'll do a boring series of live streams where I'll be building this network in Container Lab. Hopefully, you and I both will learn something new. If that sounds interesting to you, either subscribe to me on YouTube or follow me on my Twitch, since I typically tend to dual stream. This way I can save on writing the piece of actually explaining the network and just offload that to the live streaming. On a closing note, let's go by the numbers. This year, Scinet deployed over 20 kilometers of fiber optic cable. The network achieved a record-breaking 8.71 terabits per second of peak bandwidth, supported by 30 wide area network circuits. 18 of those were 400 gigabit per second circuits, 11 were 100 gigabit per second, and one was 10 gigabit per second circuit. With that, we've also had 450 access points for Wi-Fi. So this year was once again really crazy and interesting to be a part of Scinet. And I think that last year the focus was mostly on improving and implementing the IPv6 everywhere we could. The new addition to the Scinet is the HPC cluster, which I sadly don't have anything interesting to say about because that was completely uninvolved with it, basically. And I didn't manage to ask anybody in time about what the hell was going on with the HPC cluster. But this is an interesting new thing that I think will appear more and more in the next years of supercomputing and Scinet, where we actually bridge the high-performance network and some on-the-ground local HPC clustering. As previously, I would like to thank the University of Warsaw and Interdisciplinary Center for Mathematical and Computational Modeling for making this thing possible. With that, I hope you found interesting what I just showed you, and I'll see you next time.